Good morning all. Today we are going to discuss the concept of resistance and Ohm's law. So let us first start with what is resistance, and then we'll go for the Ohm's law. Then further we'll go for the concept of how the resistance changes with temperature, what is the reason, and how to calculate the resistance at different temperatures if the resistance at any one temperature is given. So let us start. So in the previous class we have seen that, so if you take a conductor and you apply the voltage across it, this is plus minus, a electric field will be produced there. The electric field intensity E is depends on what is the voltage applied and what is the length, what is the effective length of the conductor or the length of the conductor. So E will be equal to V by L. We have seen there this will be in volts per meter. Because of this, every electron and the positive charge experiences a force. Because of that, the electron will be attracted towards the positive terminal, and if you take the positive charge will be opposed or move towards from the positive terminal to the negative terminal. So this is what we have studied. As initially we have studied that initially when this electromagnetic field theory came, they have analyzed the force on the positive charge. So that's why the direction of the positive charge is called as the conventional current direction. So we have also seen that whenever a electron is trying to move, let us assume an electron is trying to move, there will be so many atoms in your material. So this electron will collide with the atom. So whenever any atom is colliding, because it moves at some velocity, because of this electric field it experiences a force, it starts moving. When it collides, it will bounce back. So when it bounces back, again it will come back, again because of the force, again it will try to move in the forward direction, again collide, come back and move like this. So as a result of this, this velocity is not equal to infinity. This velocity will be the mean value of the velocity. Because of the collisions, we have seen that mean velocity will be equal to drift velocity. Because of the drift velocity, we have seen that current is equal to dq by dt. How much value of charge is passing per second through any particular point. So that is called as the current. So we have seen that the amount of current, that means how many charge carriers are passing per second, or what is the velocity acquired by a charge, will depend on, first one is electric field. So this electric field in turn depends on the supply voltage. And the second one, it also depends on what is the opposition for the passes, like how many times it is colliding with the neighboring atoms. Or we can tell what is the ratio of the neighboring atoms, neutral atoms, to the charge carriers. So depending on that, how many collisions will be done, that will be decided. So it depends on two things. One is the collisions. That collisions is generally represented by the resistance of the material. And it depends on what is the voltage that is applied or what is the electric field that is attracting it. So whenever any atom, any element, so let us take for example an electron is passing, it hit with something. So whenever it is passing with some velocity V hitting something, because this kinetic energy will be converted in the form of a heat energy, because whenever it is hitting, so we can tell that the heat is produced. So this heat is produced because of the collisions. That means whatever energy is acquired by the electron, it is converted from the motion energy to the form of heat. So this heat is dissipated. So something is required to represent this, what is heat is produced. So to represent that, we represent using some resistance. So the resistance is nothing but opposition for the passage of current or opposition for the passage of charges. So because of this resistance, the heat is produced. The heat loss is generally given by I square into R. So how this loss comes, what is this? These things we are going to see in the coming classes. So I hope this basic of the resistance is clear. I am repeating once again. Whenever a charge try to move because of the electric field, it will collide with the neighboring atoms and it will change its direction. Because of this, the velocity will not reach up to infinite. It will move at some mean velocity, or which is called as a drift velocity. Because of the drift velocity, the current will not be equal to infinite, where current is equal to dq by dt. It will be limited to some limit. So how much value of current will pass, or how many charge carriers will pass per second through a particular point, will depend on what is the potential applied and what is the resistance of that particular material. So different materials will have different type of resistance or different opposition for the passage of current. So this I can write in a different way. So if you take a pipe, I want to pass some water. So the amount of water that is passing will depend on, let us assume I am using some pump. So using some pump, I am pumping the water. So the amount of water that is passing depends on what is the difference in the pressure. What is the difference in pressure between these two points? So let us assume pressure at this point is 1, pressure at this point is P2. So due to the difference in the pressure, the force is applied on the water, so water will start moving. It depends on the pressure. And the second one, what is this area of this pipe? If area of the pipe is more, the water can pass easily. If area is less, water cannot pass easily. And how much will be the flow, rate of flow of the water will depend on what is the pressure difference between these two points. So same thing is the case for your electrical circuit. If you take your electrical circuit, if you take one conductor, you apply some potential V. So the current that is passing will depend on what is the potential difference between these two points. Let us assume this is at potential V1, this is at potential V2. So this voltage will be V12, V1 minus V2. So this is plus, this is minus. So the amount of current passing will depend on what is the potential applied across it and what is the area, how much amount of free space is there for the charges to move easily. So it depends on the area as well as voltage. So same thing is analogous. So this relationship is discovered by a scientist called as George Simon Ohm's, and he has named it by the name Ohm's law. He has made the experimentation in the lab and he has made some observation that he has given the statement. So the statement he has given that the physical state, that is temperature etc., remaining same, that means if you are maintaining the temperature and other parameters of the conductor same, the current flowing through a conductor is directly proportional to potential difference applied across its two ends. That means current is directly proportional to potential difference applied across its two ends. Let us assume potential difference applied is voltage V. Or I can tell that this current I will be equal to some constant K multiplied by V. So what is this constant? Others, he has made another definition for this. He has defined that the ratio of potential difference applied across a conductor and current flowing through it remains constant provided the physical state of the conductor, that is temperature, remains unchanged. What is the definition of this? He has defined that V by I is equal to constant. This constant he has defined by the name the resistance. So he has given a symbol for this. This symbol is ohm. So if you are applying the voltage V across a material and a current I is passing through it, the ratio of V and I will be constant, or we can tell the ratio of V by I, which is nothing but the slope. The slope will be maintained constant. If you take the curve between voltage and current, the slope will be constant. So this is what they have stated. And this can be stated in some other form also. Based on the first definition, the current passing through a conductor is proportional to voltage. Or I can write the current is equal to G into V, where G is called as the conductance of the material. Conductance of the material, which is given by Siemens, or it will be inverse of the resistance. You can represent in any way. So G is equal to 1 by R. So let us see how to define the resistance, or what parameters the resistance depends. So again, I am taking one conductor. So this conductor is connected to some voltage source. So let us assume the length is L. So the current I is passing through this. So the amount of current that will pass, this I can make it as analogous to a congestion on a road. This is just analogous to congestion on a road. If you take a road, if a vehicle want to pass, so vehicle want to pass through a road. So how it will pass? First thing is, it will depend on what is the width of your road. And second one, how much length it should travel. If it should travel more distance, it will take more time, it is a little difficult. If it has to travel less distance, it will be easy. That means the congestion of a road depends on how much narrow or wider the road is and how much is the length of the road which it should travel in the horizontal direction. So same thing is the case for the conductor. Similarly, the opposition for the passage of current will depend on what is the length of the conductor, because as the length of the conductor is increasing, I have told the current is the net effect of the charge carriers, how they are moving after experiencing different collisions because of this. So number of collisions will be more if the length is more. So that means it will take more time. So that's why resistance is proportional. The total resistance for this entire length will depend on what is the length of the conductor. And if area is more, collisions will be less because it can pass easily. So that's why it is inversely proportional to the area of cross section. Or we can tell that R is equal to some constant I am defining rho into L by A, where this rho is called as resistivity of the material. Resistivity of the material, and the units will be ohm meter. Resistivity of the material and the units will be ohm meter. How to get it? This is in ohms. So this is in meters. This is meter square. So if you want rho, this will become R, that means ohm meter square by meter. This becomes ohm meter. So the value of this resistivity depends on the nature of the material. So let us now see the microscopic form of Ohm's law. So this microscopic formula of Ohm's law correlates your network theory with that of the field theory or electromagnetic theory, which you have studied in electromagnetics in your physics. So we have studied there the current density J is given by the current per unit area. So current I can write as, from our previous observation in today's lecture, current is nothing but V by R, because V by A is equal to resistance, or current is equal to V by R divided by A. So this I can write as V by R into A. So this you can substitute V by R is equal to rho L by A multiplied by A. I have just substituted the value of R. So AA will cancel. So this will become V by L into rho. So what is voltage per unit length? Voltage per unit length is nothing but the electric field intensity divided by rho. Or from this I can write E is equal to rho into J. So this is called as the microscopic form of Ohm's law. Or from this I can define the value of J is equal to 1 by rho into E. 1 by rho into E. This 1 by rho, that means inverse of the resistivity, I can define by the term the conductivity of the material, which will be equal to sigma into E, where this sigma is called as conductivity of the conductor. This is nothing but conductivity of the material. This rho is the conductivity, it is inverse of the resistivity. So this we have already said, studied in electromagnetics, J is equal to sigma E. This is called as E is equal to rho into J. This is called as microscopic form of Ohm's law, or the Ohm's law in electromagnetic field theory. Let us try to take one example to clarify this, then we will proceed further. So I am taking one example. A conducting wire has a resistance of 5 ohms. What is the resistance of another wire of same material but having half the diameter and 4 times the length? Sorry, I was not able to read properly. So let us try. So whenever any numerical is given, first thing you have to remember, note down the given data. So what is the data that is given? A conductor resistance, some material is there which is having initial resistance R1 is equal to 5 ohms. It is asked what is the resistance to, at some other condition, resistance of another wire having same material. Material is same, that means the resistivity will be same. So that means rho 1 is equal to rho 2. Resistivity is same. Then having half the diameter. So the diameter 2 is equal to half that of diameter D1, and length L2 is equal to 4 times the length 1. Length is equal to 4 times the length 1. So let us try to calculate this. We can tell the ratio of R2 by R1 is equal to, resistance is equal to rho L by A, rho into L2 by A2 divided by rho into L1 by A1. This will be equal to L2 by L1 into A1 by A2. So this I can write as L2 by L1 into pi d square by 4, and this also will be pi d square by 4. So if you simplify it, you will get in the form L2 by L1 into D1 by D2 whole square. So if you substitute this, the length is 4 times. L2 by L1 is equal to 4 by 1, and the ratio of D2 is equal to 1 by 2 times. So this will become 1 by 2 whole square. So this will become 16 times. So we got the ratio of R2 by R1 is equal to 16, or I can get R2 is equal to 16 times of R1. That means it is 16 times of R1 is 5 ohms. So you will get your resistance as 80 ohms. So in this way you can calculate the value of the resistance. So let us now see what will be the effect of temperature on resistance. Effect of temperature on resistance of the material. So let us now see what will happen if the temperature of any material is increased. So when the temperature of any material is increased, if you take the material, this material will have some free charges, free carriers, as well as some atoms. So whenever the temperature is increased, so whatever is the atoms are there, whatever the atoms are there, so these molecules will start vibrating. They will start vibrating. That means they will start vibrating up and down and randomly in different directions because of this thermal excitation. And the second one, whenever due to the thermal excitation, some extra carriers will be generated. That means the number of carriers that are generated will increase. So the first thing is molecules vibrates. So what will happen if molecules are vibrating? So it is like you are passing on a road, suddenly one car person above you is moving random in a zigzag way. Can you go through him? You cannot go through him. So because of that, what happens? The chances of collision will be more, or we can tell that they are opposing your movement. So what will happen? This will impede the movement. So when the movement is hampered, automatically the current will decrease. So what will be the result of this? The current will decrease. And the second effect is the number of free carriers or free charges will increase. When the number of free charges are increased, current is equal to number of charges passing per second. So as a result of this, the current, because as the charges are more, the current will increase. That means there are two things. Because of molecules vibration, the current will decrease. Because of the number of free carriers, the increase in the number of free carriers, the current will increase. Depending on how different materials behave to this, the materials can be divided into different categories. First one is the conductors. So the property of the conductors is, so number of free carriers are more. When the number of free carriers are more, automatically under normal conditions the current is more, or we can tell that resistance is very less. Resistance is very less. Now let us see what will happen. So when the temperature increases, we have seen the two effects. One is the vibration in the molecules. Number one is increase in the free charges. Already the free carriers are more. Therefore, increase in free carriers is equal to nearly zero, because already so many free carriers are there, no new free carriers will be generated with increase in the temperature. But with increase in the temperature, the molecular vibrations will be there. So we can tell that the molecular vibrations are increased, whereas the free carriers are not increased. So what will be the net effect of this? Net effect of this, I can tell my current is decreased, or I can tell that the resistance of the material increases. That means with increase in temperature, the resistance of the conductor increases because of the molecular vibrations are dominating. So let us see the second case. So the second case is, we are taking for the material, we name it as insulators or semiconductors. So some examples of the insulators or semiconductors are, insulators is glass, mica, rubber, etc. And the example of semiconductor materials, we already studied this, germanium and silicon. So for these type of materials, when the temperature is increased, because the property of this material is, under normal temperature conditions, the number of free charges is less. When the number of free charges is less, the current that can pass is less, or we can tell that resistance is very high. they act as an insulator or they oppose the passage of current. So whenever the temperature is increased, as the number of carriers is this, so number of carriers generated because of thermal excitation will be far greater than the vibrations of molecules. That means there will be vibration in the molecules also, but the number of carriers generated will far dominate the effect of the vibration of the molecules. Or we can tell that the net effect is the current will increase with increase in temperature. What is the meaning of this? The meaning of this is the resistance decreases with increase in temperature. That means for the case of insulators and semiconductors, the resistance decreases with the increase in temperature. Let us go to the third type of material. Some materials are there where the temperature will not change. Let us take for example the resistance of high resistance alloys such as ureca, manganin, constantin. Ureca, manganin, constantin, etc. So for these type of materials, the resistance is very high. So in this, when the temperature is increased, the increase in free charges will nearly counterbalance the effect of vibration of molecules. That means nearly counterbalance each other. Or we can tell that even if the temperature is increased, the current passing through it is nearly constant. Or we can tell that resistance is constant. The property of this material is the resistance will not change with temperature. So this is for the case of alloys. So I hope this is clear to you. So let us now see how to define this temperature with temperature resistance is increasing or with temperature resistance is decreasing. How to define that? That is defined by the term called as temperature coefficient of resistance. Let us now see what is temperature coefficient of resistance. So temperature coefficient of resistance. So to analyze it, let us take for the case of conductors only, not for the resistors or other materials, to make the analysis easy. So I am just taking a conductor which have resistance R0 at 0 degree centigrade and resistance value of RT at some T degree centigrade. We have just seen that for the conductor, as the temperature is increasing, what will happen to the resistance? The resistance, which is measured in ohms, will increase. So let us assume the value of the resistance at 0 degree centigrade is, the value is R0. So this value is R0. So let us take some point at temperature T. The value of the resistance, this value of the resistance is RT. So I am just defining it some letters A, B, C. This point is C. So let us try to analyze it. So it is observed practically that under normal range of temperatures, when the temperature is extremely high, the molecular vibrations may damage your equipment because of heat that is produced. But under normal temperature rise, it is observed that the increase in the resistance means final value minus initial value. The increase in the resistance is directly proportional to what is the value of initial resistance. It depends on what is the value of the initial resistance, and it is directly proportional to the rise in temperature. And it also depends on the nature of the material. So this I can summarize. We can tell that the RT minus R0 is proportional to initial value of resistance and the rise in temperature, or this I can write as RT minus R0 is equal to some constant alpha naught into R0 into T. Let us take it as equation number 1, where alpha naught is the temperature coefficient of resistance. This tells with temperature how your resistance is changing. And remember, this alpha is not constant. Again, this alpha also depends on the temperature. So it is the temperature coefficient of resistance at 0 degrees centigrade. So I can calculate my value of RT from this equation is equal to R naught will come to right hand side. This become R naught into 1 plus alpha naught into T. I am just minimizing the equation number 1. So this is my value of resistance at any temperature if you know the resistance at R naught. So from this equation, I can calculate the value of alpha naught also from equation number 1. Alpha naught will be equal to RT minus R naught divided by R naught into T. So this I can rename as RT minus R naught by R naught divided by temperature. So this I can define as increase in resistance per ohm original resistance. Original or initial value of resistance is R naught. RT minus R naught is the increase in resistance divided by per degree centigrade rise in temperature. Per degree centigrade rise in temperature. If you calculate the units, increase in resistance is in ohms, original resistance is in ohms, ohms by ohms will cancel. This will be per degree centigrade will come. It is ohms per ohm per degree centigrade rise. Or I am just defining the temperature coefficient of resistance is defined as increase in resistance per ohm original resistance per degree centigrade rise in temperature. Per degree centigrade rise in temperature. This is called as temperature coefficient of resistance. So let us proceed further. If, let us assume the conductor is having a resistance of R naught at 0 degree centigrade, R1 at some T1 degree centigrade and R2 at some T2 degree centigrade. Then using the previous derivation we have made, R1 is equal to R naught into 1 plus alpha naught into T1. Because if you want to calculate R1, temperature is T1. Initial value is R0 and the corresponding value of alpha is alpha0. Similarly, R2 I can write as R0 into 1 plus alpha0 into T2. So from this I can write R2 by R1 I can define as 1 plus alpha0 T2 divided by 1 plus alpha0 T1. This is the second one. In some numericals, the formula, this formula will be required. So I am defining the value of alpha naught again. We have just defined the value of alpha is increase in resistance per ohm original resistance per degree centigrade rise in temperature. So I can define in some another way. This is nothing but increase in resistance. I am just writing it per ohm original resistance into rise in temperature. So I can combine these two terms together, increase in resistance by rise in temperature. We have seen that curve. This is with respect to temperature, how the resistance is changed. We have seen this. So the ratio of increase in resistance, this is delta R divided by delta T. If you are taking this as angle theta, this is nothing but tan theta, opposite by adjacent, or this is nothing but the slope of this curve. So this is nothing but the slope. So I can replace this with slope of temperature resistance curve divided by the initial value of resistance R naught. This is my alpha naught. Again, I can define alpha T at some particular temperature, because from that particular temperature, at some particular temperature, I want to calculate what is the value of alpha T. So this alpha T, same way I can write as the slope of temperature resistance curve divided by what is the initial value of resistance, because I am calculating at T. So initial value of resistance will be equal to RT. So, as we know, the slope of temperature resistance curve is constant, we have just seen. So, I can compare these two as alpha naught R naught is equal to alpha 1 is equal to R 1. Alpha naught R naught is equal to alpha 1 into R 1. Similar way, if we calculate for some other temperature, I can write this as alpha 2 into R 2, etc. Or from this, I can define as alpha 1 is equal to alpha naught R naught divided by R 1. This I can write as alpha naught into R naught divided by R naught into 1 plus alpha naught into T 1. So, this we will get alpha naught divided by 1 plus alpha naught into the temperature. So, I am just summarizing this. We have just calculated the temperature coefficient at any point. If you want to calculate, if you know the initial value at alpha naught, I can get it as alpha naught by 1 plus alpha naught into T 1. So, this I am taking as equation number 4. So, same way I can get the alpha at some other point, alpha naught divided by 1 plus alpha naught into T2. I can calculate at any temperature using this. Or some cases, we don't know the value of alpha naught. We know the value of alpha at one point and you want the alpha at some other point. So, you know the two different temperatures. So, how to calculate this? So, for this, I am dividing 1 by equation number 5 minus 1 by equation number 4. That is 1 by alpha 2 minus 1 by alpha 1. This will become 1 by alpha naught T2 by alpha naught minus 1 plus alpha naught T1 divided by alpha naught. So, if you simplify this, you will get it as T2 minus T1. Or from this, I can calculate my value of alpha 2 is 1 by alpha 1 plus T2 minus T1. So, if you know the alpha at any particular temperature and you know both the temperatures, you can get alpha at any other temperature. So, remember here I am only making the derivations because once you know how to derive it, you can solve the numericals easily. That is the basic reason why I am deriving it. Again, I am going back. Let us assume I know the resistance at temperature 1. I want to calculate the resistance at some other temperature. I don't know my initial value of the resistance because we know the resistance at any temperature RT is equal to R naught into 1 plus alpha naught into T. This is what we have studied. So, this is the case. We know the value of R naught and alpha naught. If you don't know these values, how to calculate it? So, that thing we are going to see. So, let us assume the resistance is R1 at T1 degree centigrade. The resistance is R2 at T2 degree centigrade. And let us assume alpha 1 is the temperature coefficient at T1 degree centigrade. Alpha 2 is the temperature coefficient at T2 degree centigrade. Then how to calculate the resistance at that point? So, just now we have seen the slope of the graph. The slope of the graph we have calculated is R0 alpha0 is equal to R1 alpha1 is equal to R2 alpha2. It is nothing but tan theta because we have just derived it. So, this value theta, so this is delta R, this is delta T. This is with respect to the resistance. So, that slope is nothing but equal to tan theta. So, I can define by the tan theta. So, from this I can write the change in temperature. Let us assume the change in temperature, temperature is changed from R1 to R2. The change in temperature divided by, change in the resistance divided by change in the temperature is called the slope is equal to tan theta from this curve. So, from this I can write R2 minus R1 is equal to tan theta into T2 minus T1. So, from tan theta, I can write the term R1 into alpha 1, this one, R1 into alpha 1 into T2 minus T1. Or from this, I can write R2 is equal to R1 plus R1 alpha 1 into T2 minus T1. Or I can write R2 is equal to R1 into 1 plus alpha 1 into T2 minus T1. So, if you know the resistance at any one temperature, you can calculate the resistance at any other temperature using this formula. I hope these concepts are clear to you. If you still have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer to your queries from there. If you want any specific help, you can just leave your email ID there. So, I can reply back to your email with if you need any material or anything is missing for you. Thank you. Thank you very much.